I just found out I needed to be at all the locations the county has. So now, with this, if we can get this in place, I wouldn't hire election judges, I wouldn't hire election workers. That would all go through the election administrator for the county. And by the way, that's, Mariano. So, all right.
Does this also include a runoff if it needed, anything to do with?
Yes, I do think it does, right?
It has the runoff, the pricing for a runoff is included.
Is not included, but on the last sheet, there is a numbers, an Excel spreadsheet with some numbers on there. But other than that, I mean, basically, I handle postings. I do all the postings and everything as normal and take the applications. And then she will just handle the, early voting, election day, and do all the LNA on the machines. She will do all of that. She will take care of.
Can you budget for all of this?
Yes, it should be in our budget. Wherever the county has their elections and it falls in one of those boxes, 103, 206, 207, wherever they choose. Right now, Commissioner's Court has to approve them, and then I'll bring them to you as far as early voting dates and times, late nights, and locations. And I'm right now planning to bring that back on the first week in August, the first meeting in August, because we have to order the election, and you'll get the early voting. We should have that by then. All the locations and the early voting dates and times.
So the numbers that you're looking at, the city of Forest was $12,946 for the election, and 50 cents for the election.
City of Forest, yes, that would be our portion.
Because the other one ties into what we'll talk about next.
Right. And ours, we do own two of the ballot boxes and two of the electronic machines to do. I'm going to keep possession. I mean, the city will still own them. I'm just going to give them to her because she can do the service on them. And we just have to pay to keep the licensing. That way, if it changes at some point, we still have ownership of them. But I will take them to her, and she can do the maintenance and everything with her machines and use it.
Any other questions or any questions for Monica or Olga? Okay, I will, and if there is no other comments, I will take citizens' comments at this moment. If there's any citizens at this point, do you have anything? Okay, then I will entertain a motion to enter into an election agreement with Wilson County to conduct a joint election.
I'll make the motion that we go into an agreement between Wilson County and the City of Forest.
I have a motion on the floor by Councilman Nissen. Do I have a second?
I'll second.
Seconded by Councilman David Johns. All those in favor, please raise your hand. All those opposed? 3-1. Thank you. Moving on to item 3B, consideration action to enter into an election agreement with FISD, the Forestville Independent School District, to conduct a joint election.
This is just a matter of protocol, I guess, because see, we have, the school has to do a joint election with the municipality.
Yeah, this is where the statutes come into play. So the school district has to do a joint agreement with another political subdivision that's holding an election. We're the only ones, since it's an off year, that are holding the election, so they have to contract with us. We're having the county run ours, so then it's essentially a tri-party agreement. They'll contract with us, we contract with the county, but they'll still be paying their fair share, which is why we're only paying for half of the county on there, and they'll be footing the other half of the bill.
They will do an agreement with the county also.
As well.
So it's, it's not, well, before it was, they would pay us. Now they'll pay the county. We just have the interlocal with.
And this is a procedural issue under the statutes.
So both entities, ourselves and the FISD, would be paying $12,946 and 50 cents for a total of $25,803.
Correct.
Yeah. Any questions for Monica? Any citizens' comments? I will entertain a motion to enter into an election agreement with FISD to conduct a joint election.
I'll make a motion that we do an election agreement between the city of Forestville and the Forestville Independent School District.
I have a motion on the floor by Councilman Nick Mason. Do I have a second? Seconded by Councilman David Johns. All those in favor, please raise your right hand. All those opposed? Thank you. Thank you very much, Mark.
You're welcome.
Item three C, consideration of action to approve a variance request for a septic system for Renee and Chastity Garcia.
Good evening again. What I have tonight is a variance request by the Garcia family on 121 Flores Court. It's a half acre. It was brought to the Planning and Zoning Commission June 7th. It was approved and recommended for council to approve as well. The property owners met with our public works director, Mark, and he did verify that the city could not provide sewer to them because of the distance and the elevation of the property. And so they are requesting to be allowed to put in a septic system. Currently, they're going through the state with TCEQ, but they will not get a CO until we get a copy of that permit and final inspection.
I'll get an attention to approve.
Hold off on that until I, is there any questions for Mark since you've dealt with this, any situation that you wanted to talk to the council about, or if the council has any comments about it?
Well, just for the council, though, we went out there, took measurements, and shot the grade, and we'll end up missing final grade by about 32 to 36 inches. So it was such a disparity that there was no possible way for us to get the gravity flow.
Any other questions or comments? Any citizens' comments at this moment? Okay. Now I will entertain a motion to approve a variance request for septic system for Renee and Chastity Garcia.
I move to approve.
I have a motion on the floor by Councilwoman Cantu. Do I have a second?
I'll second it.
Seconded by Nick Mason. Councilman Nick Mason. All those in favor, please raise your right hand. Thank you. 4-0.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Item 3D, consideration and action to approve street closures for the Knights of Columbus March for Life. And I know I have representatives from the Knights of Columbus here, so if you would mind coming forward and telling us about your project and what the city committee will allow.
Thank you, Worthy Mayor, City Council. My name is Joe Rodriguez. I'm with the Knights of Columbus here in Florida, Texas, and we're here to extend an invitation to our annual Respect for Life March, which will be on October the 7th, beginning at the Casey Hall, and we'll be marching to the Sacred Heart Catholic Church. And this is our annual march, and we usually come before y'all to extend an invitation and to let y'all know that we're gonna. We usually basically come to for permission for uses of the street for the march. And what we basically do is we get a police escort and then we march on to Sacred Heart Catholic Church in prayer and peace, love, for respect and life. We're just here to basically send an invitation and permission for city council and you for permission for respect for life.
What time would that be?
It's gonna.
It'll be at 9 a.m.
And the street closure would up and down.
They'll usually begin at the church, at the hall, and go up downtown, go down to trail, and turn right to Buffalo's and go to Sacred Heart Catholic Church. We march on Trail Street. And we basically just do it with a police escort.
Okay.
And we're working on getting that taken care of and getting all the details taken care of.
So we've done this before, correct?
Yes.
We have a map.
I totally have met with the chief because, as he said, we don't usually have a case or anything because it's a march. It's usually over with here for about 45 minutes to an hour, and they usually just bump the police and suggest for it. I thought the chief was here.
Yeah, we're going to get with him and work all the details out or whatever details we need to work out and get it all put together. And if we need to, we'll get you a our schedule and all that cheating to your office and let you know what we have going on.
Sounds good. Any comments or questions for Mr. Rodriguez and the Knights of Columbus representative? So, any citizens' comments at this moment? Yes, ma'am.
Good evening, I'm Sarah Kennedy, and I just want to say thank you to the Knights of Columbus for doing this, and I hope the City Council will approve it. It is a wonderful testimony, and I think it just reflects well on the city to support an event like this, because I definitely believe in the sanctity of life, and I very much appreciate what Knights of Columbus do to help promote that, and I think it just does wonders, and I believe it will help bring the Lord's blessing on our community, and I just really appreciate y'all being open and allowing that to happen. Thank you.
Any other citizens' comments? At this point, I will entertain a motion to approve street closures for the Knights of Columbus March for Life, and you will work those out with our police chief.
Yes, sir.
Okay. I'll entertain a motion.
I'll go ahead and move to approve street closure.
I have a motion on the floor to approve the street closures for the Knights of Columbus for October the 7th, 2017 at 9 a.m. Do I have a second?
I'll second.
Seconded by Councilman Jacob Silva. All those in favor, please raise your right hand. Thank you so much. We look forward to it.
Thanks to the council.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Excuse me. Moving on to item 3E, consideration action to approve the 2018 Wilson County Appraisal District operating budget.
Yes, I give the regrets from Jenny Holloway from the appraisal district. She had an emergency. I could not make the meeting, even though she had confirmed that she was going to be able to make the meeting. She did want to say that the budget doesn't have very many changes in it. However, she did want me to point out that staff did receive a 5% increase raise in salaries, but to note that they did not receive one the previous year. I believe she said that had an increase of about $2,000. And they also had to make some amendments because now the new appraisal district building is complete and they made some concessions in the budget for the construction. But again, she did apologize. I saw her at 1 o'clock and she said that she would see if she could make the meeting, but apparently she didn't.
So we can ask you questions, you won't have no answers.
I would have no answers.
So they had 9 good changes in it. I was curious about why they put contingency funds and stuff. They already had up, they already increased.
I said, that's the message.
Yeah.
That is their budget. Now, historically, the City Council has requested and said for someone to come and speak if you all had any questions. If you'd like, we can see if we can schedule it for another day for the next meeting or a previous meeting, but I believe they are in the process of approving this budget. But if you have any questions, Jim will be more than happy to answer.
Is this the finality here? We don't have no input on this except this talk.
Correct. It's their budget. They're going to properly approve this budget, but they do take it to all of the bodies that they represent.
seconded by Councilman Johnson. Do I have any citizens' comments? If not, all those in favor of tabling item 3E, please raise your right hand. 4-0, thank you. Moving on to item 3F, consideration action to issue a directive to the city manager regarding security requirements for city council meetings. This was brought to my attention after June the 20th, that there was nothing in writing, no directive, no nothing in writing when it comes to security. So I asked Mr. Hood and Henrietta Turner to kind of sit down with me and or sit down and come up with a plan, and this is what I have before you. And in it, you can read it if you would like, or if you want time to read over it. It's the purpose of the city council, City of Floresville City Council Directive Number 9, Directive Regarding Security at City Council Meetings. And the protocol compliance with responsible security procedures to ensure appropriate safety to elected officials, staff, employees, attendees, and others at meetings at the Floresville City Council. So the council has had a chance to read through it. Do you have any comments or questions about it?
I thought we already have this.
There was nothing in writing.
Who normally would be in charge of, if, since this becoming in writing, is it your responsibility or this city manager's responsibility?
I asked about it because as mayor, I am the one who is responsible for the city council meetings. I was told that, no, I was not when it came to employees of that. According to the city charter, the city council, including the mayor, cannot directly or indirectly direct staff. If there's an issue that you want to have done with staff, including the police chief, you have to give directions to me. And then I have given directions to the chief. Which I met with him earlier about today, as well as other occasions, with phone call as well. So you have to give directions to me because council cannot direct publicly or privately staff.
Thank you. Is this something that should eventually be written into the consent charter, or does it stand as direct?
And somebody on that.
The direction of staff, sir, the question, or?
In regards to security for city council meetings.
You have to ask the attorney about putting
I don't think that would be something for the charter. I think because of the way the charter's set up, and this is about the appropriate, we could have an ordinance of the city that requires it, but really this is directing Henrietta, and then Henrietta's directed to work with the chief. And then the chief will arrange because he's the one that's over the officers who would actually be appearing. It says the chief or the chief designated officials. I believe informally it's always been Detective Ortiz who's kind of been managing this. So the chief can keep it that way and work with the detective, or the chief can do it directly or however they want to do it in-house. But it'll direct the council to Henrietta and Henrietta to the police chief.
Security, thank you. Slice water.
Process to change the charter. Very long process.
In other words, if you've been here 10 years, you're on.
Any other citizens' comments? Okay, if no other comments, I'll entertain a motion to approve the, consideration action to issue a directive to the city manager regarding security requirements for city council meetings.
I'll make a motion to approve the directive regarding security at the city council meetings, directive number 9.
I have a motion on the floor by Councilman Nissen. Do I have a second?
I'll second.
Seconded by Councilman Jacob Silva. All those in favor, please raise your right hand. All those opposed?
Oh, no.
Three. All right, moving on to 3G, consideration action to establish formal rules of protocol and decorum for city council meetings. This is not anything that is mind-boggling or changing any standards. It's reminding people, and including our council, including the media, about rules of presentation here in the city council meetings. You have in front of you, council, rules of procedure, conduct, and decorum at city council meetings. I'll read part of it. I know it's a very long one, but we'll go through it so the citizens know what we are dealing with. Whereas the city council of the city of Floresville is tasked with the governance of the city and holds meetings of a variety of manners to gather information, take action, obtain input, and assist in the administration of the city. Whereas a critical part of such meetings is obtaining citizen input to hear the opinions, thoughts, and ideas of members in the community. In addition to the rights granted to each member of the public under the First Amendment, the laws of the state of Texas and the charter of the city, responsible governance requires that citizens and affected individuals of the city be given a voice before their governing body. Whereas such input must be of a nature to ensure civil discourse and prevent intimidation, discriminatory, inflammatory remarks, or personal attacks that would derail the sharing of ideas and detract from the purposes and goals of the city, of the meetings of the city council. And whereas it is therefore necessary to enact written and universal guidelines for conduct and decorum at city council meetings that apply equally and fairly to all. Therefore, be it established by the City Council of the City of Floresville that all regular, special, emergency, workshop, public hearings, town halls, and executive session meetings of the Floresville City Council will be called and conducted in accordance with the provisions of the Texas Open Meetings Act, Chapter 551, Government Code. Number 2, regular, special, and emergency meetings and workshops of the Floresville City Council are open to the public and to representatives of the press and the media. In accordance with the exceptions established in the Texas Open Meetings Act, executive sessions of City Council are not open to the public, the press, or the media, and only those individuals expressly requested or ordered to be present are allowed to attend executive sessions. Number 3, the Floresville City Council adopted Robert Rules of Order in the 11th edition at the special council meeting on June 21st, 2012. Except where in direct conflict with the city ordinance or state laws, the rules of procedure among the members of city council shall be governed by these rules. The mayor or mayor pro tem in his or her absence shall conduct any meeting of the city council pursuant to section 3.01b of the charter and shall be the presiding officer of any meeting of city council. At meetings, the City Council, the business of Floresville is conducted by and before the members of Floresville City Council and by those members of the staff, elected officials, department heads, consultants, experts, and or members of the public requested to be present and participate, while the public is invited and encouraged to attend all meetings of the City Council except executive session. Again, the public's participation therein is to be governed by the following. A, audience participation is limited to the role of observers except for during the designated comment periods or unless a member or members of the public is requested or invited to address the City Council on a particular issue or issues. Members of the public in attendance at a regular, special, or an emergency meeting or of the Commissioner's Court of the City Council shall conduct themselves with proper respect and decorum in speaking to and addressing the City Council. In participating in public discussions before the city council and all actions in the presence of city council. Members of the public speaking during comment periods or invited to speak shall remain behind the podium while speaking. Also, each member of the public who appears before the city council shall be limited to a maximum of 5 minutes to make his or her remarks during general comment period, and a maximum of 1 minute to make his or her remarks during the comment period following each consideration and action item. During public hearings, each individual shall be granted as much comment time as necessary, provided that the speaker remains on the topic of the hearing. Time for each speaker shall be maintained by the mayor as presiding officer or such other designated representative as he or she deems fit. During such comment periods, each individual is to address the city council and not prior speakers, presenters, or other attendees. I know this is long, but it's important. Also, item D, it is the intention of the city council to provide open access to the residents and affected persons of Floresville to address the city council and express themselves on issues under consideration by city council. In accordance with such, members of the public in attendance at city council meetings must be respectful of individuals making citizens' comments before, during, and after such comments are made. Item E, it is not the intention of the Floresville City Council to provide a public forum for the demeaning of any individual or group. Neither is it the intention of the City Council to allow members or a member of the public to insult the honesty or integrity of the City Council as a body or any member or members of the City Council individually or collectively. Accordingly, profane, insulting, threatening language directed toward the City Council members of the public, whether in attendance or not, or any racial, ethnic, or gender slurs will not be tolerated. Violation of these rules may result in the following immediate action: cancellation of the speaker's remaining time, removal from the meeting, or such other civil or criminal sanctions as may be authorized under the Constitution, statutes, and codes of the state of Texas, or ordinances of the city of Floresville. In addition to the foregoing, any refusal to abide by these rules of decorum and or disruption of the meeting may result in a request by the presiding officer from the Floresville Police Department to remove the offending party or to file criminal charges for disruption of a public meeting under Chapter 42.
Excuse me, Mayor, we have a request for information. Mm-hmm. This goes to the attorney.
Yes, sir.
When we have guest speakers come up and talk, is this included?
Yes, they must remain behind the podium. Not only...
I'm talking about the insulting words, profanity.
Yes, it applies to anybody before the council. And it applies to council members too. Council members are covered under Robert's rules.
You know where I'm going?
I think I'm going to.
Thank you. Thank you.
Moving on to item B, special rules for the press and the media. No media personnel or equipment, including lights, cameras, or microphones, will be located closer than 10 feet in front of the city council dais or the table. Item B, reporters and media technicians are required to structure their movements, equipment setup, and takedown and adjustments, etc., in such a manner as to not disrupt the city council deliberations or the ability of the public to see, hear, or participate in the proceedings. Also, interviews by reporters, either print or electronic, shall not be conducted inside the city council meeting room during the time of the city council in session. And also, media interviews which are conducted outside the city council meeting room shall be conducted in such a manner that the interview does not disrupt, impede, or disrupt the proceedings of any regular, special, emergency, workshop, or other executive session meeting in the of the commissioner's court. It says here, Chris, can we change?
Should be city council.
City council. Item six, the Floresville Police Department's appointed representative shall serve as the beta at all meetings of the City Council. It shall be the duty of the City Manager to coordinate with the Floresville Police Department on procedure for such. However, in the event of the absence of the Floresville Police Department, or in the event that there exists a conflict of interest between the Floresville Police Department and matters before the City Council, the presiding officer may appoint such other commissioned peace officers to serve as betas as if necessary. And in addition to the aforementioned meetings, from time to time the City Council may conduct town hall meetings and public hearings. These rules of procedure, conduct, and decorum as set forth herein shall also apply to such town meetings and public hearings. However,
the city council may adopt such additional and supplemental rules for such meetings as may be necessary and appropriate to conduct such meetings in an orderly, efficient, and proper manner. And item number 7, these rules of procedure, conduct, and form of meetings